Hi, welcome to Virginia Time Travel, your portal to the Commonwealth's past, present, and future. We often think of the Founding Fathers as being old men, but even the Founding Fathers were once young. George Washington was commissioned to survey the frontier when he was 17, and Benjamin Franklin ran away from his apprenticeship to explore the city of Philadelphia and to make his mark on history. If you've been to as many reenactments as I have at colonial houses, you might think that everybody in colonial America was born middle-aged, but such was not the case. And to prove that, we have a very interesting group here that wants to bring history back to what it was, young, middle-aged, and old. And we have with us today some folks from McLean High School, and Project Enlightenment. Dean Howarth, who is the director of Project Enlightenment, and Sarah Corey, who is one of the students and participants in this very interesting project. So welcome to the show.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you.
So, what is Project Enlightenment?
Well, Project Enlightenment is a curious admixture of sort of education, community service, and learning, obviously. It originally started as an interdisciplinary club at McLean High School 20 years ago with lots of different teachers involved in doing what we thought would be a one-off performance at the Corcoran Gallery in Washington, D.C. And it was so successful that it kind of just kept going and kept going and kept going. And even when other teachers left who were contributors, I was sort of left behind with this wonderful program. And I kept it going all these years. And the extracurricular club, where the students do student-designed reenactments at historic sites in the area, has now, thanks to the foresight of our administration, turned into an actual accredited course in living history at McLean High School.
And this has been going on for over a decade, hasn't it?
Easily. We, in fact, just recently had our 20th anniversary at the Corcoran Gallery of Art, where we recreated an 18th century French salon, so it was très chic.
And as I mentioned in the intro, I go to a lot of reenactments, and you never see young people. And I saw your group out at Ripon Lodge in Prince William County, and it was just striking because I was thinking, yeah, this is the way it really was. I mean, so it was really very interesting. Now, I understand your background, Dean, is physics. So, what took a science teacher and has got him in 18th century garb?
It's like a man walked into a bar or some crazy story like that. But it's as the physics teacher, when we originally did the first performance, which was a recreation of a French salon, we thought that salons were known for having people from all different fields, scientists, writers, politicians, soldiers, artists, what have you. I was in charge of the scientists, so I sort of oversaw the brothers Montgolfier and Antoine Lavoisier, the student who was portraying him. And that was my sort of pigeonhole responsibility at the beginning, although I was one of the three founders of the original idea. That was my segment. And after that, I sort of just learned more and more about different versions of history, because I have always believed that interdisciplinary studies really make school come alive. So I've been proud to be a dilettante in many other fields as well as physics now.
And I understand the students actually learned science by kind of studying the origins of the 18th century science that then led to some of the other breakthroughs?
Absolutely. We hear all the time as a science educator, STEM, science, technology, engineering, and math, and it's as if it's a new thing, but Benjamin Franklin and Joseph Priestley and the like, they would have been just as into STEM as we are today, and it had to come from somewhere. I like to say STEMs have roots. And we found that learning, and Sarah actually portrays Benjamin Franklin's daughter, she's learned a great deal about Benjamin Franklin's electricity and his scientific discoveries by understanding the basal fundamental aspects of the science, which I think is very crucial to a real appreciation of an esoteric field like physics or chemistry.
So Sarah, tell me how you study the person you portray and how you learn science from doing that.
Right. Well, for me, it was pretty easy studying a lot about Benjamin Franklin, because there's a lot of books about him and things that he wrote too. So most of the time, I got all of my research from his actual diaries and his letters that he sent out. And we actually had the honor to go to the Library of Congress and the archives there and look at the actual original books that were handwritten and that he used to do his research. And from that, we actually have a lot of the experiments and the different models that he would use. So we take our knowledge and we would test it, like how he would test his experiments. And that's how I got to understand a greater amount of electricity and how he would work it. Mm-hmm.
Now, was his real daughter involved in any of his experiments? Or?
He would send letters about his research in France, but Sarah Franklin Bache was more involved in the war aspects, and she was more stay at home, and her husband was a person who did trades as a merchant, so she was more involved in that aspect, but I wanted to follow along the science realm.
So now I understand you all appear at a lot of different venues, mm-hmm. the apothecary shop in Old Town and Mount Vernon. What is it that you do?
Well, normally, although we started and we've been going to Mount Vernon for a very long time, and we also visit Montpelier down in Orange County, but we have a near and dear place in our heart for the smaller museums in the area, like Gadsby's Tavern or Carlisle House or the Stabler Ledbetter Apothecary. And our goal is to sort of give them something for free that would bring people in at no cost. So when we go to these smaller museums like the Apothecary Shop, it's a perfect environment to conduct scientific experiments or talk about medicine or natural science, because those things happened in places like the Assembly Room at Gatsby's Tavern or right in downtown Alexandria. So we do things like recreate scientific society meetings that bring out the nature of the site as well, because we like to use the site as a teaching tool as well as just our own interpretations.
Mm-hmm. And how many students participate in any given year?
Our entire group is anywhere from, let's say, 35 to 50 people. We actually even include an 18th century girls' chorus of about 14 girls who work with us. And over the years, I figure we've been doing it 20 years, there must have been nearly 500 students involved as interpreters over the years. And there's a great quote by Henry Adams, who said, "A teacher never knows where their influence stops." I always like to think about how many students that people like Sarah have touched, and just visitors to Mount Vernon or Gatsby's Tavern, and then take what they've learned and teach their students, and then their students teach their children. It's a very satisfying enterprise.
And now the student enrolls in this as a course under history, science, what?
it's actually sort of an orphan floating around the building. We seem to have the only class like it of its kind, and we're actually in the performing arts department, not being so much on the history content, because they have wonderful history teachers and they learn a great deal of history in their other classes. But we spend a lot of time learning how to craft what we do to make it effective, the same way someone who takes a class on theater learns how to have stage presence. And there's factors that are very similar to living history that we study in class, as well as do things to tweak our content and language and style of the times. So it's there is an actual legitimate curriculum that goes along with it that makes it a legitimate course.
I noticed that you've enlisted some of the French speakers from a French class who are going to be part of this upcoming salon.
Indeed,
is that right?
Indeed. When we had our French salon, we figured, well, we can't be a bunch of American students pretending to be in Paris without a few French speakers. So it's another way of making it an interdisciplinary leap. If we can get someone in the French class to work with a physics teacher who's working with history students who also have music students, it's a wonderful sort of like watershed of a lot of, you know, collective genius that's coming together. So we're more than happy to have French. We've even had Russian characters in the past.
So Sarah, where do the costumes come from?
Well, it's a mix between the costumes that have been provided in recent and past years from other students. For instance, the dress I'm wearing was made, it was handcrafted by one of my best friends. Oh. And she sewed it all herself, and she actually donated it to the program. So a lot of our clothing and articles are donated from other people, be it like theater goers or individuals who made their own dresses like this one.
And it's taken us a very long time to have 50 18th century costumes,
yeah,
because sewing is a bit of a lost art inside the Beltway.
So you've got about 50 in your wardrobe.
Yes, indeed. My physics room is quite chock full of things that don't look like they belong in a physics room.
So how many students have participated over the 10 or 15 years that you've been at this?
Like I said, there have been, if you have 30 to 50 a year, just going back, we figure it's in the hundreds. And the connection aspect of that, if each one of those students talks to 10 people at the course of a day at Mount Vernon, and they probably speak to a great many more than that, the ripple effect is outstanding, and it just continues on and on. I always like to say it's funny to think of like how many people in Wichita have a picture of you in their album for their vacation photos, which is kind of an interesting thing that you sort of like haunt through people's lives as we teach them things.
So are other schools and universities picking up on this idea? I thought I read something about the University of Virginia even picking up on this.
There was actually some of our alumnists who go on to University of Virginia, and a great many go to William and Mary and various other schools, have pursued things like this in their new places where they're studying. So if there's an avenue for it, they have pursued it. But as far as we know, there's no other school that does anything like this in the region. And we've presented at national conferences, and no one has raised their hand and said, oh, we do this too. So we like to think that we're blazing some new territory.
Yeah. At Ripon Lodge, you portrayed an astronomer, which mm-hmm. I thought was absolutely fascinating, because I never even think of 18th century astronomer.
Oh, you should.
Just give us a little snippet on him.
Yes, I was playing David Rittenhouse, and I grew up in Philadelphia, and we would go on field trips to Rittenhouse Square, where near the Franklin Institute and Carpenter's Hall, and you just thought of it as a place named Rittenhouse Square, and it turns out that David Rittenhouse was America's preeminent astronomer, who corresponded with all the great scientists and astronomers in Europe and participated in international astronomical collaborations. So it was a great way for me to bring out some history that was in the back of people's minds, like they've heard the name, but to find out that this man was a legitimate scientist of the caliber of Edmund Halley, let's say, or William Herschel.
And that's fascinating. So let me ask you one of our signature questions, and I'll ask Sarah first. Mm-hmm. Why is it important to study history?
Well, I think history has so many amazing features that you don't realize affects our life today. For instance, you take for granted the electricity that runs a building, but if you know the history behind it, you can understand more about how it functions and how it helps you out. And for me personally, learning the history behind a lot of the sciences helped me understand the science course better that I would take in high school. And I think it's really important that everyone knows where things originate from.
I find that the unique vantage point that history has is that every field has its history. So it doesn't matter whether you're studying, even computer science. And we found that you can more deeply appreciate what's gone into the historic events that we find on our SOL tests or on our textbooks, if you understand the human drama behind it. And that's the nice melding for living history and conventional history, is we get to bring a human side to it that I think makes people just feel like, maybe the past was a little bit more like today than it was different from today. And I think that that's a very powerful lesson that an audience can pick up from that there are things to be learned based on that connection that we have.
So Sarah, what is the most important thing that you've come away from the course with?
Well, I would think the most important thing is to not take history for granted, and that you can actually educate the masses through historical things such as this, and that there's a lot more to history than just the textbooks.
Great. Now, I understand you all are going to do a demo for us, the kind that you do when you go out, and can you just very briefly give us an intro to that?
Indeed we will. We'll pretend that it is a meeting of a scientific society, and we'll show a little bit of the science of Benjamin Franklin and his associate, Dr. Rush, who was a doctor in Philadelphia at the time, and a young lady who is portraying a naturalist.
Great. Well, we look forward to doing it, so let's do it.
It's interesting that a lot of people know Benjamin Franklin as a great founding father and how he presided and participated in these great congresses of politics in 76 and 87. But Benjamin Franklin also presided over great congresses of scientific inquiry that were known as scientific or philosophical societies. In fact, he founded the American Philosophical Society. And today what we have is essentially a couple experiments of the type that would be shared amongst the scientists and just curious minds in general of the time. And it became a concept behind American pride to share scientific discovery in a way that would advance the culture. So what we have here today is a collection of electrical experiments, medical experiments, and some natural sciences. So I will turn it over to Miss Sarah Franklin Bash, who is the daughter of Benjamin Franklin.
On many occasions, my father would do a lot of experiments on electricity, one of his greatest intrigues. A lot of times his experiments would be run with an electrostatic generator here, which, when turned in the correct direction, would create a current. This current could be magnified using Leyden jars. And on some occasions, he would set up a multiple lightning rods that would do the same purpose as this, creating electricity. And he'd connect them like this to this bell right here. And when the power is generated and the static begins, the bell will be magnetized and create ringing sounds. In his household, he had multiple bells set up to multiple lightning rods. And on one occasion, the lightning rods, which was reacting to a major static storm, caused a multitude of bells to ring all across the house. My mother and myself were awoken to the noise and was not able to sleep again for another 2 hours because the lightning storm did not end. Electricity was one of his major interests, but he wasn't very careful about his experiments. On one occasion, 2 days before Christmas, he was doing an electricity experiment on a turkey where he was charging it to see if it would cause the turkey to be roasted, to be eaten for Christmas. However, instead of demagnifying the two bolts right here, he accidentally touched it with his hand. And because we humans are electrified as well, he actually got shocked and was frazzled and almost fainted at the shock because it was so large for the turkey that he almost couldn't attend Christmas dinner because of it. And our whole family was worried for him because he never took the time to make sure that he wouldn't come in contact with any of the lightning bolts or any of the lightning rods or any of the metal that was charged. And he would often shock himself, which was one of the greater experiments. Shocking themselves in this time period was a lot of fun. And on occasions, they would actually do this for fun during parties. On one instance, the electrified Venus was utilized as a means for suitors to be sworn away by a beautiful young lady. Her father said that if a suitor would kiss her as she is charged by one of these electrostatic generators and was willing to stay with her afterwards, then they were allowed her to be wed. However, the shock was so great because us humans carry electricity and can travel it through ourselves into another person without getting shocked, that all of the suitors either fainted or ran away. And this poor woman was left by herself because no one would be willing to kiss her and get the shock.
It was commonly the case in Paris, especially before electricity took the notion of being a practical science, that it was used for dalliances like this. They would string small boys from the ceiling, electrify their feet, and draw sparks from their nose to light candles and the such. And it was quite the charming parlor game. But Dr. Franklin's great addition was that he realized that the electricity that we make in the laboratory is similar to the electricity that comes from the skies. And that led to the wonderful invention to which Benjamin Franklin gained no profit of the lightning rod. At the time, it was called lightning points. And they were now common all over Philadelphia and throughout the entire nation. But another interesting aspect to this, and Dr. Rush will speak to this, there were some scientists who noticed that since electricity can pass through living organisms, maybe living organisms were related to or could be cured by electricity. Care to comment, Dr. Rush?
Yes, the field of medicine was a very interesting aspect of electricity. Stories were circulating all around from electricians that patients were getting shocked and recovering sense of limbs that were believed to have been permanently paralyzed and other such incidences. In fact, one such incident was a young girl of 8 years of age in London who fell from the second story of a building, only to fall into a severe coma for several days. When the electrician heard of this severe incident, he helped revive her by shocking her. The process was done in...
It was often the case where they would just simply have ribbons connected to electric lines like this, and I would take them across my hands, to which Dr. Rush would then connect them to the apparatus, which would deliver a rather uncomfortable shock. And I personally believe that the doctors reported great success, because what was actually happening was the people were so put off by the discomfort that of course they claimed that they were cured, and they would move on to other pursuits of in medicine. So these notions, there were even dentists who would apply shocks to your teeth with wands, which I would imagine would be ever more painful. But this sort of quackery led to people like Mr. Perkins, who invented electrical tractors, which we have a pair of that my associate can display. These were thought to use metal and electricity to cure people. George Washington actually purchased a pair of these, and some people insisted that it was true science. But we can compare things like this to the work of Mr. Mesmer in France, who was conducting a quackery of his own, who Dr. Franklin helped debunk. And not only was it the physical sciences, but the natural sciences as well. Thomas Jefferson was a great natural scientist who was also a presider over the American Philosophical Society. And we have one of his greatest treasures here.
Yes, Thomas Jefferson was extremely enamored with the woolly mammoth, which I have a tooth of to show today. As you can see, it demonstrates the enormous size of these creatures. People are so incredibly fascinated by these in this era that they actually have a colony-wide contest to see who can uncover an entire mammoth skeleton. And one is eventually uncovered in New York State.
It was actually assembled in the first museum in America by Charles Wilson Peel. And lucky diners could actually have dinner sitting at a dining table underneath the assembled mammoth.
Yes, the mammoth was not the only creature that impressed people at social events. However, like electricity, natural science was something that brought wonder, especially to the rich and powerful. This moose antler actually tells a similar story. Thomas Jefferson and a French gentleman named Buffon had a long-standing argument over degeneration theory, which states that all animals in the Americas are just degenerated versions of European animals. However, Thomas Jefferson sent an entire moose skeleton to Paris to be assembled in a French hotel, and it so impressed the Parisians that Buffon took back his theory and accepted American greatness.
And it was Thomas Jefferson's Notes on the State of Virginia, which was one of his greatest words put to paper other than the Declaration of Independence, that were written to defend Virginia's flora and fauna specifically against the theories of the French scoffers at the greatness of America. But the mammoth became a cause celeb, the moose became a cause celeb, even lowly things such as skunks and birds and fish that we take for granted became things that we were very proud of. So the scientific principles of the day became something that we were clearly using as a leverage for our new nation onto the world scene. And these were the sort of things that went on in the scientific societies of the day. And today we can still see that peer review and sharing of science is something that is inherent to the sciences. So we feel that understanding the bases of scientific principles like these, and that the histories of the men and women who discovered them, make an esoteric field like science all the more attainable. And us, if we were to understand principles of science, technology, engineering, and math, as the president claims that we are so crucial to our future, you must also understand that the stems had roots.